Mike Schroeder has lived in Arlington Heights for 55 years. He attended Dryden, St. James, and St. Viator High School. Mike received his Bachelor of Science in Professional Studies from the University of Notre Dame and his Doctorate of Dental Surgery from the University of Illinois College of Dentistry. He has served and is serving as a member of the Northwest Community Hospital Dental Advisory Board and has served as an Arlington Heights Village Trustee, Village President, and is currently the Wheeling Township Supervisor. And I can honestly say, Mike, I think most people in this room would rather sit in your dental chair than those last three, I would imagine. Mike, I think out of those, Mike and his wife, Cindy, have four children and have been attending Harvest Bible Chapel in Rolling Meadows since 2001. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Mike Schroeder.
Thanks, John. Good morning. Mayor Hayes, First Lady Sue Hayes, fellow chamber members, family, friends, and guests. Every one of us has a story to tell. For all of us here today, we still have unwritten chapters. For those younger in our crowd today, more chapters to write. For some of us who are older, maybe not so many chapters left. Each one of us has a story, and our story has one author. Many of you know parts of my life, but not the whole story. This is my story. I love Arlington Heights. My family loves Arlington Heights, and I've lived in our community for over 55 years. My mom and dad, Frank and Betty Schroeder, moved to Arlington Heights in 1954. The year I was born, and the year my father started his dental practice in a building on Northwest Highway that now is home to Wayne's Pizza. I currently live in my 12th home in Arlington Heights. 10 of those have been on the north side of the train tracks. I would like to say I'm a North Sider, but I can't because I'm a Sox fan. If 12 homes seems astronomical to you, you have to know our family. It started small, but just kept growing. First Kathy, then Mark, then me, Joe, Laura, Mary, Monica, and Kurt. We had an 11th member of our family, Alma White. She loved all of us and our friends. Alma was a centerpiece in our family. She loved her soap operas and was the inventor of interactive TV. When a character came on the show who was stretching the truth, she told them, "You lying? You lying?" She also loved her Bible, and I would see her reading it regularly. She was my first introduction to the Bible. Alma died in 1981 while living with my sister Mary and her husband Steve in Elk Grove. We were all thankful that she was part of our family life. We didn't get out much to neighborhood restaurants because we all ate like a bunch of animals. Or so I was told. Our restaurant choice was Jake's Pizza in Mount Prospect because we could throw peanut shells on the floor and listen to people ask my mom, "Are these all yours?" I went to Dryden School for kindergarten and really didn't enjoy school. I could be found hiding under the evergreens in front of school, and my mom was called to see why I didn't show up. First grade was no different for me. When my sister Kathy brought me to school at St. James for that first time, I was crying hysterically. And my first grade teacher, Sister Jean Marie, calmed me down and escorted me into the classroom. I always thought fondly of my first grade teacher, and in 1985, when I joined our dental practice, we were reacquainted. Sister Jean Marie, now Sister Margaret, has been a patient in our office for over 50 years. She is here today with Sister Barbara, formerly Sister Jeanine Marie, who also taught first grade at St. James and has also been a patient in our practice for over 50 years. While I was in grade school, junior high, and high school, the Boy Scouts were a big part of my life. I loved the achievement of merit badges, and in 1969, I was awarded the highest achievement of scouting, Eagle Scout. I also learned about life priorities through the Scout Oath. On my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country and to obey the Scout law, to help other people at all times, to keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. Scouting showed me that the priorities were God first, others second, and then finally yourself. Unfortunately, I didn't always follow those priorities, as I will discuss later. At St. Vider High School, the rigors of academics continued, but my passion was in a 45 by 110 foot room in the basement that housed the swimming pool. To make the swim team, you had to swim 50 yards in under 36 seconds. I made the team by swimming in 35.9 with just a tenth of a second to spare. I didn't have the innate talent of my good friend Mike Salerno, who won the state championship in the 100-yard backstroke. But as was my norm, I worked hard, and during my senior year, I was co-captain of the team. We swam 7 miles a day in peak season and trained over Christmas break at the Swimming Hall of Fame in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I was even able to meet Mark Spitz and his coach, Doc Councilman, and found out that there was a book called The Science of Swimming. I used that book to sharpen my skills as a swimmer, and it became a big help to me in funding my education at the University of Notre Dame and the University of Illinois Dental School. I managed swim pools and coached swim teams in Arlington Heights, Palatine, Franklin Park, and Oak Park. Always driven to achieve, we racked up conference trophies in each of those communities. When I graduated from dental school, my father helped me with the purchase of a dental practice in Rockford, Illinois. I spent 5 years in Rockford, but it seemed a lot longer than that. I met Cindy when she was assigned to my office for her dental assisting internship. Bottom row, second from the right. We were both dating other people at the time, and when an opportunity came up to become part of my dad's practice in Arlington Heights, I asked her if she would work with me 3 days a week in Rockford and then 2 days a week in Arlington Heights. We traveled back and forth to Arlington Heights, asking each other questions and sharing dreams. We fell in love and got married in June of 1986. And God has blessed us with 4 wonderful kids. There's one other thing I would like to tell you about my background. There is a personality test called the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. On that test, I am an introverted, intuitive, thinking, judging personality. I live in a world of ideas and strategic planning. So I spend a lot of time inside my own head. Some would say, in my own little world. As a strategist, I am always scanning available ideas and weighing them against my current strategy to plan for every conceivable thing that can happen. So when I read in the Bible that I should trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. What that said to me in preparation for this prayer breakfast was, stop gathering information, stop gathering data, and speak what God has put on my heart to share. So that is what I want to do today. Have you ever noticed how often God uses the crises of our lives to get our attention? This is how God gets through to us with crystal clarity. In his book, The Problem of Pain, C.S. Lewis said, "Pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our consciences, but shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world." I admit that God has had to shout to get my attention many times. On the outside, my life looked good, but my family, in various ways, always paid the price internally for what I was chasing in the world. God has used crises in my life to change my focus and my direction. More specifically, here is what God taught me from the three crises that he allowed me to face. Life is short, so focus on having an eternal perspective and a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Then pass those priorities on to your children. Here's how God shouted to get my attention in three crises. The first crisis God used was in 2003. Besides being a husband to Cindy and a father to Sarah, Emily, Nathan, and Jacob, I owned a dental practice. I was the Wheeling Township Supervisor, a 50% partner in Arlington Developers, a real estate development company, and the newly elected Wheeling Township Republican Committeeman. I was also a follower of Jesus Christ, and on the evening of my election, he was saying to me, "If this is what you want, and this is what you value, you can have it all." But when I won the election, I immediately felt the weight of it on my shoulders, and instead of celebrating inside, I was depressed. Never in my life have I felt so much pressure on a daily basis. It was hard to get up in the morning and know what hat to put on to start my day. My nights were always spent at meetings, and my wife told me how alone she felt. Something had to give. You see, in the world of self, the goal always moves. Whatever I was chasing was never going to be enough. Village trustee, mayor, township supervisor, real estate developer, committeeman, there was always another goal. Even the rich builder King Solomon learned this. He said in Ecclesiastes, "I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun." I asked Dennis Nelson to be my spiritual mentor, and when I won the election for committeeman, he asked me, "Mike, what are your priorities in life?" I said, "Well, I know what they should be." Clearly, I had much work to do. Shortly after the election, Cindy and I began biblical counseling for our marriage. In our second session, the counselor said, "Mike, most men have a hard time handling the responsibilities of husband, father, and one job. You have three. What's going to give?" So I said I would resign my position as committeeman, but my beautiful wife started sobbing. You can't do that. You won't be able to give that up. At that moment, God made it crystal clear my priorities were wrong. They were what I wanted, my dream, my ultimate self-achievement projects. My achievements had taken on a life of their own, and they came to a crashing end. Driven to succeed, I had been climbing the ladder of success, only to find my ladder was against the wrong wall. God showed me my priorities were upside down. Everything had to change. I started by resigning my post as Wheeling Township Republican Committee. That may have seemed crazy to many back then, since I had just been elected to the position, but it was a step towards personal sanity in my priorities. I then dissolved my real estate partnership, and over the next several years, many things changed. I joined a men's small group at Harvest Bible Chapel and started developing some real accountability with other men. I first thought this would be more of a hand-holding kumbaya group with men sharing their feelings and ending up with a worship song. I knew the questions that men usually ask each other. What do you do for a living? What's your risk tolerance in your 401k? Where do you live? Always comparing, always measuring to see where you were on the ladder of success. Even in the Bible, when Jesus asked the disciples, what were you arguing about on the road? They kept quiet because they argued about who was the greatest. But this small group that I was in was different. The last 15 to 20 minutes of our small group involved real accountability. Random questions were asked. How many days have you spent in God's Word this week? Have you watched anything inappropriate on the computer or your television? Do you have an internet filter on your computer or iPhone? Why not? Have you prayed with your wife this week? Are you serving in the church in some capacity? Big questions that I really needed to focus on. Daily time in God's Word wasn't a priority for me. I usually didn't turn to the Bible unless I was worried about something. And serving in the church wasn't even on my radar. You see, I didn't just need to prioritize what was in my schedule. I needed to schedule a brand new set of priorities. If my priorities were to be Jesus first, others second, myself last, my schedule needed to reflect that. In March of 2007, Harvest Bible Chapel offered a dental mission trip to Benin, Africa, and I volunteered to go. We prepared for our trip with meetings at church. We prayed that the name of Jesus would be honored and that he would be given the credit for everything done. We thought we might do some cleanings and extract some teeth. From the beginning of the day to the end of the day, we did extractions on loving people who had some real dental problems. We had no x-rays and worked on a church bench with a garbage bag that was duct taped to it for spitting. We extracted several hundred teeth, and our motto was, no root left behind. It was a life experience I will never forget. And the following year, I went back with my son, Nathan. Both of us learned from that experience how blessed we are. The second crisis that God used to get my attention involved my mom's health. In late 2007, my mom took sick and didn't get better. She was hospitalized, did rehab at Luther Village, and then went home. She did this tour three times, and each time I could see she wasn't getting better. This caused a personal crisis for me because I wanted to make sure my mom was going to heaven. Mom was everything to our family. She was the glue that held it all together. I'll never forget when Mom told my brother and me that Grandma Tess, on the left, my mom was on the right there. When Grandma Tess died when my mom was 2 years old, and our grandmother Laura was really Mom's stepmom, I cried that day as a kid and realized how hard it must have been to raise her 8 kids without a really good roadmap. But she did it, and when I became a parent, I realized how much work went into that. Just putting a meal together every night for 10 people was a giant undertaking. And she did everything with love. My mom loved being with her family, and she enjoyed eating sweets. When she was at Northwest Community Hospital, she loved their oatmeal and its cinnamon sugar topping, probably more than the oatmeal. When she moved from the hospital to Luther Village, I wanted to make sure she had the hospital oatmeal with extra topping, and I used to bring it to her as often as I could before work. When visiting her, I typed out 2 Bible passages and printed them in very large letters. They were 1 John 5:11 through 13. And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. My mom was also suffering from being anxious after sundown, so I also shared Philippians 4, 6, and 7 with her. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We prayed together, and I am confident my mom is in heaven. The third crisis God used to get my attention was my own health. Cindy and I like to exercise, and this past spring and summer, we were really into it. We have a 3.5-mile route we cover. We walk about 1.5 miles, then we jog the next 1.5 miles, and then walk home. We usually exercise 4 or 5 days a week. To stay fit, you need to exercise a little bit almost every day. In our jogging portion, Cindy started to notice my breathing became labored and I was slowing down, which I later learned she chalked up to my old age. I started to notice that my stomach was a little swollen and I had some lower left abdominal pain. The pain was minor at first and only during the jog, but the next couple of days the intensity and the pain increased, so I went in to see my doctor. He thought it was gas, but said if the pain continued, we should do a CT scan. Well, the pain continued and I scheduled the CT scan. I figured my appendix needed to come out. While waiting in the reception room at the hospital, I noticed a middle-aged woman sitting next to me with a turban and no hair on her head who was waiting her scan. I prayed that her results would be no tumors. After the CT scan, I made it to my office for my 10:30 patient, but within a half hour, my doctor called and told me my spleen was 4 to 5 times the size it should be, and I would need to have it removed. My initial reaction was one of shock. I sat on the phone and listened to my primary care physician recommend Dr. Lorenz Group in Arlington Heights. I had only one question from my doctor. Was Dr. David Mann in the surgical group? He said he was and asked if I knew him. I said, he will be doing my surgery. Dr. Mann is a long-term patient of our practice, and I knew that he would take care of me. My wife and I thank God that we did not have to investigate who would be doing the surgery. Dave called me that night after looking at the scan and confirmed what my physician had told me. Cindy and I scheduled the consultation 5 days later and went in to hear the talk. After hearing what the possibilities included, cancer, lymphoma, Hodgkin's lymphoma, and leukemia, we didn't have many positive thoughts to walk out with. I remember Cindy asked if I felt better than when I went in, and I said no. We knew it was all in God's hands, and our prayers turned to Him. I had to clear 1 month off of my schedule at the office, and our prayer warriors went to work. From the CT scan to the surgery took 1 week. Dr. Mann told us that it would take 48 hours for the pathology report, and since my surgery was on a Thursday afternoon, we probably wouldn't hear the pathology report news till the following Monday. On Saturday morning, Dr. Mann came into my room in the hospital and told me that he wasn't going to go home until the preliminary report was in his hands. Cindy and I were walking around the hospital floor when I got the call from Dr. Mann, and the result wasn't preliminary, it was final, and it was a benign hematoma. I was the unexplained 2%. As Cindy and I laid in the hospital bed that evening in tears, we both looked at each other and said, almost simultaneously, God has given us another chance, and we need to get it right. I'm privileged to have many here today who have lived life with me. None of us know how many chapters we have left to write in our own story. Achievements and goals keep moving. You're never satisfied. But if anything in this life has an expiration date or burns in a fire, it has no lasting value. The goal is Christ, and He doesn't move. If we believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord, we are saved. It is a ticket for one. As for me, I didn't need to prioritize my life as much as I needed to prioritize my wife. She is the most important human relationship I have, and God gave her to me. And as the day of the Lord gets close, Malachi 4:6 says, He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Our kids are our legacy. Success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal. There is a book, and it has one author. And to know him, we need to read God's word, just like exercise, a little bit every day over time, and he will reveal himself to you. 5 years ago, my wife asked me to listen to her favorite song. I listened, but I didn't really hear. I'd like to play that song for you, and then I have one final comment to make.
Beautiful wife, always smiling, but on the inside.
in my Bible on July 4th, 2015, just about 50 days before my surgery, I underlined the following verse, 1 Peter 3:10. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.